here to express our love for the Lord and worship, and we're doing that on the second Sunday of Advent. We're going to be learning more about this season throughout the service and how we can respond, not just today and not just in the days of the week, but in the posture of our lives as well. Two things I want to mention as we get started. We would ask that you please refrain from using your cell phones during the service. You can put them on silent, you can turn them off. We just ask to put them away because they can disrupt the live stream broadcast. And we lose that. It's none of several minutes before we need to get it back up. So we don't want those worshiping with us virtually to lose that experience. So we appreciate your help with that. Also want to say thank you to those who came out yesterday for the hanging of the greens to adorn the sanctuary and the church. We thank you for your time, for the nativity afterwards and the other decorations. We thank you for your time and service. This is the first Sunday of the month. We will be celebrating the Lord's Supper. So if you haven't already, there are communion elements in the back. And if you're worshiping with us virtually, we ask that you please prepare those elements in your hearts beforehand. Also, we mentioned that following worship next week, December 12th, immediately following worship, we'll have our annual congregational meeting, and that will be to elect officers to present the 2022 budget. There's copies in the back if you need that. If you're worshiping virtually, you can request those if you like. And also to vote on the pastor's terms of call. We want to mention those on the slate for election included for Elder Kathy Barnes, as well as for deacons Jason Barnes, Joanna Keller, Sharon Martin, and Mary Rowe. So we want to thank them for their willingness to serve. And again, that's next Sunday following worship. At this time, I want to invite Joe Lotus to come forward and give us an update on our Christmas happenings and surveys.
Good morning. I need to update y'all on the Christmas basket so far. We still have 5 single families that we don't have sponsors for yet. So if any of y'all are thinking of sponsoring a family or willing to do that, please sign up on the sign-up sheet that's in your bulletin today. And I'll get that information to you sometime today. And also on the collection process, of course, it's kind of normal for here, but some people come to me and ask me what we need. And so far this year, we're a little bit behind on collecting. So, if people are waiting till the last week, if you're going to buy stuff and if you want to get it in pretty soon, I can do an inventory and know more about what we need. Because at this point, we need some of everything. So if you have any questions on that, just see me after the service, and I appreciate all you all have done. And I have 5 different people that we didn't have telephone numbers for, so Dennis and I are going to go and try to find those houses and those families tomorrow. And if any of you all who are sponsoring Christmas baskets, if you've called your people several times and cannot reach them, let me know, and we'll do what we can to try to find them too. It's a process I have to do every year. We usually have to find 6 or 7 families. So, and we're going to start that, Dennis and I are going to do that tomorrow. Thank you.
Hey, Joe.
Yes.
What about boxes? Do we need to bring boxes?
Yes, how many boxes? I've got some set up, but I usually get them. Yeah. I was going to talk to you and Ron after service. The facts are bringing that up. Anybody else has any boxes, you're welcome to bring them and put them on the bleachers of the gym. Thank you all.
Thank you, Jim. Are there other announcements? Let's prepare our hearts for worship.
Good morning. I have a couple of words to say before the prelude, and then later I'll talk a bit about the rest of the two. But when I read the scripture, Isaiah 40, so many songs, so much music popped into my head. Most of it from Handel's Messiah, because he used that a lot in his works. But the choir has done a song called Every Bell. This is actually a keyboard And then verse 4, where it talks about every valley shall be exalted, and every mountain made low, and crooked straight. That's what that scripture is. And then the postlude, well, it also has verse 5 with it, which is the glory of the Lord shall be revealed, for the mouth of the Lord has spoken it. You'll hear all this scripture from the pastor in a little bit. The postlude just uses and the glory of the Lord part. But as I was playing this prelude in every valley, and I got to that part about that, you know, everyone is going to know about this, and the mouth of the Lord is spoken. And I know Isaiah was saying that to a people who were waiting for Messiah. Well, we've already had him waiting for him to come back. But I thought about that verse in Philippians where it said, every knee shall bow, and every tongue confess, and it's going to be heaven, earth, and under the earth. And it just hit me that that is going to happen. Isaiah said it. We heard it in the New Testament in Philippians. So better hold on, because I get kind of loud at the end, because it's just so exciting to think, yes, the Lord has said this, and it is going to happen. A couple things about the composers. John S. Beck was born in 1930, and he might even have some contemporaries here, but you don't have to hold your hand. But his music is very lyrical, with these long, gorgeous phrases. And then Handel, who was born in 1685, his music, this is the postlude, is more of a shorter melodic line. It's almost percussive. So somewhere between 1685 and 1930, some of the styles changed, but that's okay. So let us worship as we hear.
Thank you. Today is the second Sunday of Advent, a day for pondering the peace of the Promised One. This peace is the peace we know in our hearts as we live our lives for Jesus. It is a peace made possible the world over through the coming of the Messiah.
Luke 2:11-14. The angel said to the shepherds, "Today in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is the Messiah, the Lord." Suddenly a great company of the heavenly host appeared, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth peace to those on whom his favor rests."
Because the angel promised it, this ray symbolizes peace on earth, the peace available to all who put their trust in the Prince of Peace.
Let us pray. Thank you, God, for sending your Son Jesus into the world and for the true and everlasting peace that he brings. Help us to offer your peace to one another each day. Amen. In the coming week, consider all the all-surpassing peace that has been given to us, peace with God and with each other, all because Jesus came.
Church, let's stand and sing together, "Hark the Herald Angels."
Yeah.
sung, as we will hear and ponder and be amazed. Lord, still too often in our day-to-day lives, in the rush and the commitments, we forget that call. We may remember a little bit more this time of year, but it is a call that you have placed upon us to not only be ready, but to prepare the way. Forgive us when we have been distracted and have been pursuing other things that we have not been participating in the work that you have for us to prepare the way for our King. So Lord, forgive us. We pray that you capture our attention again and that we will be captivated more and more by the one who has come and is coming again. Lord, we thank you that through him we are forgiven and restored. So may we be preparing the way for you. We pray this in the name of our Savior. Amen. Hear this word from Isaiah 43, beginning in verse 5. Do not be afraid, for I am with you. I will bring your children from the east and gather you from the west. I will say to the north, give them up, and to the south, do not hold them back. Bring my sons from afar and my daughters from the ends of the earth. Everyone who is called by my name, whom I created for my glory. I am the Lord, and apart from me, there is no Savior. Friends, do you hear it? That not only are we given that call to prepare the way, God's done it for us. He's prepared the way through our Savior Jesus Christ. Wherever we are, we're able to come. And to know that because he died and rose again, we are forgiven and have new life. This is the good news of the gospel.
All right, thanks be to God.
You may be seated. And at this time, we want to welcome
Thank you.
shepherds left their flocks and came to see and worship Him once upon a Christmas away in Bethlehem. And all the world rejoiced because the King was born at last. A
Let's continue to be in wonder and awe as we turn to God's word. Isaiah chapter 40, beginning with verse 1. Hear the word of the Lord. Comfort. Comfort my people, says your God. Speak tenderly to Jerusalem and proclaim to her that her hard service has been completed, that her sin has been paid for, that she has received from the Lord's hand double for all her sins. A voice of one calling in the wilderness, prepare the way for the Lord. Make straight in the desert a highway for our God. Every valley shall be raised up. Every mountain and hill made low, the rough ground shall become level, the rugged places a plain, and the glory of the Lord will be revealed, and all people will see it together, for the mouth of the Lord has spoken. A voice says, cry out, and I said, what shall I cry? All people are like grass, and their faithfulness is like flowers of the field. The grass withers and the flowers fall because the breath of the Lord blows on them. Surely the people are grass. The grass withers and the flowers fall, but the word of our God endures forever. You who bring good news to Zion, go up on a high mountain. You who bring good news to Jerusalem, lift up your voice with a shout. Lift it up. Do not be afraid. Say to the towns of Judah, here is your God. See, the sovereign Lord comes with power, and he rules with a mighty arm. See, his reward is with him, and his recompense accompanies him. He tends his flock like a shepherd. He gathers the lambs in his arms and carries them close to his heart. He gently leads those that have none. The word of the Lord.
Thank you, God.
Please pray with me. Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of of our hearts be pleasing in your sight. Our rock and our redeemer, our king and our shepherd. Amen.
Amen.
Pardon me for a moment. My glasses are very foggy. So Pastor Barry Light shares this story. I was 9 years old when I rode my bicycle to the Strand Theater to see Gone with the Wind. My mother was surprised when I walked into the house a couple hours later. "What? Why are you home so soon? I thought you rode your bike to go see the movie." I told her that I had, and the movie had been over for a while. Well, she questioned me a little more before she began laughing. See, I thought the movie had ended. The Yankees had burned Atlanta. Scarlett was in the ground, vowing that she'll never be hungry again. And then there was that fancy word on the screen that I thought meant the end. It said intermission. And everyone got up, lights turned on, and I figured it's time to go, so I left. As far as I was concerned, it was over. It would be years before I would see the second half of one of the greatest movies ever filmed. Now, whether or not you agree with that last claim, my point is that the book of Isaiah is a bit like that. This intermission, this long time in between. There's a long intermission between Isaiah chapter 39 and Isaiah chapter 40. Years and years. So as far as some are concerned, the relationship between Yahweh and his people was over. After the destruction of Jerusalem, after the exile in Babylon, what else was left to happen? It was almost a century of what one commentator calls a God-muted time. And then comes our passage. Then comes Isaiah 40. And just like the incarnation of God's Son, it sounds the beginning of a new chapter in the relationship between God and his people, his covenant people. And it's an interesting scene, this chapter 40. We may think it's simply a conversation between God and Isaiah, but something else is going on here. It seems it's actually a scene of someone mysteriously present in the heavenly council being commissioned. And the one commissioned to come in power is not just the long-lost descendant of David and rightful heir to the throne. He is more. He is much more. If you listen to these verses, we see that all the resources of heaven are involved in the fulfillment of God's divine plan. This is a beautiful passage. There's a reason why so many songs and hymns have been made. But I want us to consider not just looking back at some passage and some spoken words thousands of millennia ago. I want you all to take a moment and try to see how God looks at us, you and me, as we look at that passage, to see how his perspective is often vastly different than how we sometimes feel. The remnants of the Jews in Babylon, feeling out of place, feeling forgotten, were probably tempted to lose their faith, to lose their identity. But far from being a forgotten group of exiles, this covenant community is the hot topic at the command center of the universe. This is who God is on God's mind. He's about to do something. And so we might feel like just a tiny speck on a tiny planet in the cosmos. But see how the God who created it all looks at you. Heaven is about to change the shape of human events, current events on earth forever. And so God gives this command. And I don't think it's to the prophet. It's to someone in that heavenly council. The Father says, and it's a double command, comfort. Comfort my people, which as Pam has mentioned, those are the opening words to Handel's Messiah. And most people are pretty much familiar with the Hallelujah Chorus, but this is how the masterpiece begins. Comfort ye. Comfort ye, my people, saith your God. Speak comfortably to Jerusalem, crying unto her that her warfare is accomplished, that her iniquity is pardoned. The voice of him that crieth in the wilderness, prepare ye the way of the Lord. Make straight in the desert a highway for our God. Every valley shall be exalted, every mountain and hill made low, the crooked straight, and the rough places plain. And so we hear those words, comfort, comfort. But it's important to understand that this comforting is an urgent task. That this comfort is not simply, not merely an expression of sympathy. They're there. Things will be better. I'm sure it'll work out. Until then, you have my condolences. No, that's not what's going on here. The Hebrew concept of comfort, Nahum, which is the name of another prophet, means turning away from suffering. And it includes both the emotion of compassion, which we see in all that Christ did, as well as the activity of bringing relief, which we saw in all that Christ did. And so I wonder who this commissioned one is. So look at all, look at all the aspects that God includes in this comfort. But I'm just going to mention two. First is tenderness. Literally, speak tenderly to the heart of Jerusalem. This is very personal. That we see the love of our God, his concern for his people. And second, and this is even more profound, is pardon. That Judah's guilt was being freely pardoned, her penalty paid in full. It even says that the sin debt is paid twice over. Who has that kind of power to remove that much transgression? Who else fits that role and takes away our spiritual debt like this? Only Christ through his life and death and resurrection. Also, I find it very interesting that why does God say that this outstanding debt has been covered twice over? Well, possibly the time in exile was the first part, right? A kind of national sentence that has been served. But Christ's life of obedience and his sacrificial death still to come. That's the second paid in full payment to address the eternal wages of sin and death. So you see, paying it twice over is not a matter of the heavenly accountant getting it wrong, not paying attention, and so overcharging God's covenant people, forcing them to pay twice what their sin is worth. It's quite the opposite. This is God being gracious, meeting our need with his extravagance, that the penalty is counted as satisfied, not because of a calculated amount of the people's suffering, but because of God's incalculable grace. So moving on to verse 3, we see this is kind of a key part of the passage. We hear the command, make straight a highway through the wilderness, through the wasteland for our God. Make a highway. Now, with all the grumbling that goes on with road construction, that may not seem all that impressive. But remember this context. We're talking about the return from Babylon to Jerusalem. The distance would have been about 500 miles away as the crow flies. But with all of the meandering with caravans, it probably would have taken twice that distance. So God is making a strong statement, not only about the return, but the manner of his coming to bring them home. We often just keep those things separate. The exile, people coming back and preparing the way for the king, and not see how these go hand in hand. But there's another hidden implication that throughout the ancient Near East, this common practice of preparing a highway for the return of a victorious king. And to consider what a highway would have been in that time. word, with a way, would encounter these impossible barriers, they're to be leveled, they're to be surpassed. Nothing is to keep God from coming. So whatever the uncrossable chasm is found, a bridge is built over it from God to us. And here God specifies that the surface of this highway is to be as level as possible to prepare it fittingly for the coming of this King. But as we think of the King of glory leaving heaven to come to us, coming in such a meager way to a peasant in a feeding trough, we discover that the prepared road meant for a king is the one that he offers to us. Removing every barrier that would prevent us from reaching him. That the incarnation is the ultimate highway in the wasteland, the level path so that we might have every opportunity to be brought back to God and to know the peace that is found in our Messiah. Jesus is even a greater sight than the welcoming gates of Jerusalem. Again, remember the people coming from Babylon. With verse 5, the Jews would have thought of the people's long-awaited entrance into this great city, this high point. But I think of something else. Think of someone else. Listen to verse 5 again. Then the glory of the Lord will be revealed, and all the people will see it together. Now that's not talking about Jesus' birth, for very few saw that. But a great many saw his crucifixion. But many is not enough. It says all people, all flesh will see it together. So I believe that this also includes Christ's return, his coming again. This is the season of Advent where we are anticipating the second coming, the second Advent arrival, which the authors of the New Testament tell us every eye will see. You know, again, this isn't just something to look back upon. This isn't just fascinating theology. We need this good news for us today at a time when people are more and more turning away from God, gradually closing their minds to Him, gradually letting their faith grow cold. Because it was circumstances like these that caused God to tell His messenger to cry out in the wilderness, clear away for the Lord. What's the point of this passage? What's the big idea? He's coming. He's coming. Prepare, He's coming. Now maybe you're still stuck in a Babylon of your own. Maybe you're feeling out of place, or abandoned, or forgotten, or desperate. If so, this comfort is for you. This pardon is for you. This pathway is for you. But here's the thing. Preparing a straight highway means that there is participation required on our part. That it means removing the obstacles in our lives if we're to prepare a red carpet for the King. You see, the wasteland is a picture of life's trials and sufferings, and we're not immune to these, but our faith need not be hindered by them. For the hope of Isaiah 40 harkens back to the hope of Isaiah 7. Do you remember that chapter? The Lord Himself will give you a sign. The virgin will conceive and give birth to a son, and will call him Emmanuel, God with us. It's only when we're grounded in that hope that we can do our part in preparing the way for Christ's coming. You know, one of the parables of Jesus, which is actually a reading for Advent, is seldom used because it's so dark. It's so violent. It's the one about the vineyard owner who sent servants to his vineyard to collect the harvest payment from the tenants who had been leasing the land. But those tenants, those supposed caretakers, killed the servants. And then the vineyard owner said, well, surely they'll respect my son. He sends his son. The son is also killed. And the parable finishes with this warning of judgment looming over those wicked caretakers. Quite an ironic, tragic word they were not living into, caretakers. So the owner is God the Father. The servants that came and were killed first, those are the prophets, as we see Isaiah also, like from our Lord today. The Son is Jesus Christ. So what does that make us? We're the caretakers, and the powerfully implicit question is, how will we receive the Son? I wonder, do our preparations really provide the best welcome possible? I wonder, how prepared are we to be stewards of God's kingdom, to be builders of the king's reign? Perhaps a hearty dose of repentance should be added to our Christmas to-do list this year. So as we wrap up, I want us to think again about that level path in verse 4, with those curves straightened and those rough places smoothed out to make way for a king. Now skip to the end of our passage, verse 11. And it almost feels like this is a different book. He tends his flock like a shepherd. He gathers the lambs in his arms and carries them close to his heart. Same person. The conquering king is the comforting shepherd. That tender care, speak tenderly, that tender care which God calls for at the beginning of the passage. We see here again at the end the tender care that the shepherd provides to each one of us. That he carries those who are weak and worn. That he's attentive to those who struggle and who hurt, who have heavy burdens. Is that you this morning? I'm sure it's been you at one point. Probably will be you at another point. And I guarantee there's someone very close to you in this building and outside of this building is there right now. God's people have a shepherd. And in Christ, God stands ready to shepherd, to lead us out of any captivity that we might find ourselves in. You know, the story of Isaiah 40, when you get really down to it, is a story of Exodus. A second Exodus. The first one, God delivered his people out of Egypt, giving them a covenant, an identity, a future. And here God is delivering his people again from Babylon, bringing them home through a wilderness back to the land he promised them at the start. But as the new covenant people, those who know the one who came, who was born, we know that underneath, at the center of God's plan, is the promise of the greatest exodus of all. The deliverance of his people from the captivity of sin and death. Through the birth, life, crucifixion, and resurrection of Jesus Christ, our Lord. He's the great shepherd. And so with that wonder of wonders in our minds and in our hearts, are you ready for a new Exodus this Christmas? Are you ready for the Lord to come? Even so, come Lord Jesus. Amen. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you that you've come. Thank you that you are coming again. We thank you that you have prepared the way, and that you went the indescribable distance to us to pay our sin debt doubly over. And so, Lord, we pray that we also participate, that we return, giving you praise and thanks, knowing you are our hope, and we pray in your name. Amen. So, as we prepare to come to the Lord's table this morning, hopefully you had your elements. We have those, we'll get ready to use those in a second. But we want to ask, as we come to this table of the Lord, how do we prepare the way? How do we prepare the way? joy and hope and proclamation that he's coming. And through the Spirit of the living God, he's here. So as we come to that table, may we remember all this happens because of Christ. Would you pray with me? Lord, as we come to this table, we pray that you will prepare our hearts to receive you again. Forgive us. Restore us. That we may be people preparing for your coming. We pray this in your name, Jesus. Amen. On the night that our Lord Jesus was betrayed, he took bread and asked in remembrance. The body of Christ broken for you. Take and eat with thanksgiving. Same way after dinner, Jesus took the cup. And this is the new covenant sealed in my blood, shed for the forgiveness of your sins. As often as you drink it, do it in remembrance of me. The blood of Christ shed for you. Take and drink with me. As often as we eat the bread, we proclaim the Lord's death and his resurrected life, that he has paid that sin debt on our behalf until he comes again. Let us be ready. Let us be prepared. And now let us pray. Lord, we thank you for the gift of your life. We thank you for the gift of this table, that we will always remember your grace poured out on us. May we never forget, but may we also know that we do not simply remember, we do not simply look back. The Lord's work, as we prepare the bread for the King. Also, we're going to the entering time of prayer, not only to dedicate those gifts, but also to pray for one another. So first we want to ask, what joys, what celebrations do you have? This is a celebration continue prayer. Elbert is back home, Elbert Taylor. As many of you may know from the prayer man, he had suffered a heart attack. But he had several stents put in. One was pretty complicated, so they had to prepare 2 days after the first stent. So he's had several put in, but he's home and recovering. And we're thankful for that. And Louise has definitely been in his corner the whole way. The Lord's been using her, for sure, as a comfort and as a safer. So, let's be praying for that. Are there other joy celebrations? Jamie?
Chris, I think we all need to thank God for being able to gather again as a congregation as we gradually refill the church and just pray for the health of our nation physically and spiritually, and thank God for Riverlawn.
Absolutely. Thank you. Kathy.
I just wanted to say that, again, this time of year, I say this every year, but it's especially bad time for the patient care bags because of the homeless. It the holidays and the cold weather drives them into shelter, and that's the hospital a lot of times, especially when people deal with believe it, or he was scared of it, or he was frightened. And he took the bag, and then they took the boxes, and they went back into the hospital. But I sat there a minute. I watched him open the bag, and he was so, what we take for granted, he was so excited going through that bag, and he laid everything out on the sidewalk. He laid everything up to the sidewalk, and just like it was the biggest treasure in the world to him, and he examined everything, and then he took them all, put them back in the bag, and he just sat there. I don't know. It was just the biggest blessing to watch this man get this, and he doesn't know I'm watching, and he doesn't, and I can't approach him because he's at the hospital, and he's supposed to be. I'm supposed to know about him, so I just wanted to share that because if you all could have seen how he unloaded that in the bag, which is just it's just a big gallon freezer bag with a few little travel things in it. But he took everything out and laid it out and like he was checking it off. It was just a wonderful blessing, and it was, I think, God's way of showing me this is helping these people, just to give me that blessing, because sometimes I think, I really wish I got to see these people, and I knew we were helping these people, whatever, so I just wanted to share that, because it helps people, it really is something that is worth doing for these people.
For those who aren't familiar, or just need a reminder, we do have hospital care bag ministry for those who are exiting the behavioral health unit at CAMC. And many of you have given unto that over the years, and donations of money that so items can be purchased as well. If you want to learn more about this amazing ministry, you can see Kathy. But we do give thanks. We are able to see Christ in others, and by His grace, hopefully offer His love in return. So, we thank you. Thank you, Kathy. Are there others? Barb?
I just wasn't going to say anything, but because Kathy just did. So, Kathy, I just want to thank you for sharing that, because I have been personally struggling. And this morning I realized I have so much to be thankful for. And what you just said is just, you know, puts it in that perspective of the folks who are struggling with mental health and the challenge of this season alone, but just in general. I just thank you for your ministry, what you're doing, and for what you just shared, because I needed to hear that. So thank you.
Thank you. And I imagine that some in the congregation, I imagine a lot of those words with those verses, we aren't able to hear this very well. So we're going to try to find a way to hear this better for you guys. But this is an opportunity to give thanks to how God takes that, which is often discarded or minimized, which is seen to be broken and not worth. And he will show just how precious his creation is to him. And we have the privilege of being able to not only receive, but to participate in his love. So, other concerns? Gail and Susan, yeah?
I would like to share that I have She has congestive heart failure and is on oxygen 24 hours a day now, and has not been able to get out of bed. So she's up there all by herself, and really encourages her to get a phone call, a card, a visit, something like that. She treasures her church family and appreciates all of our prayers.
We shared that cell phone through an email blast, but if you need that number, we need that too. So thank you, Gail. We'll be praying for both that gentleman as well as for the judge. Sue.
Just remember Sarah and many other Marshall students this week begins finals, so this is a hard week for all of them, and to also remember those that are traveling home from Marshall this week.
We will. Thank you. Jim.
Chris, I would just like to ask for continued prayer. My family, my extended family. Right now we're dealing with 14 of those members have COVID. Some of them are pretty serious with it, and my brother's sister-in-law died. She's 54. She died of COVID last week. It just seems to be running rampant through my family, extended family right now. I covet y'all's continued prayers for healing and for peace as the ones that are dealing with this, and then also for healing and comfort for the ones who lost their mother and wife, Lester.
Thank you, Joe. We are praying. And Rose. Kathy.
I would want to ask a prayer for a little boy named Peyton William. He's like 12, and they took him to the hospital, and they thought he had pneumonia. But after a CAT scan, they found a large mass in his lung, one lung, I guess, a lymphoma, I believe it is. And it's a totally, they had no idea that it did anything like this. And just prayers, because it is cancer, they haven't started treatments yet, but they're working on that. But just pray for him and his family. It's just it was such a big shock. They just never, ever dreamed this was what it was. So they need the family and and for it, the doctors and for whatever treatment they do, the Lord's with them.
Thank you. We're praying for that family, for him, for Peyton especially. Let's pray again. Lord, as we are well aware, we are people with great need. Often it's compounded. Often we feel helpless and overwhelmed. Sometimes we're in the center of it. Sometimes we're so close to those who are hurting or fearful or grieving. And sometimes we're further out than we hear, and we wonder, what can we do? So Lord, we pray that you move in your people. That we will be those who imitate Christ as we hear the words of Isaiah, comfort, comfort. To know the power of Jesus Christ to come and to not only feel compassion, but to exhibit, and that we have a hope and we have a healer. And so we lift up our loved ones, our friends. We lift up those who have been spoken and those unspoken. And we pray that you move us to be your hands and feet,
as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Church, in hope, let us stand and sing together, Angels from the Realms of Glory, verses 1, 2, 4, and 5. Forget the former things. Do not dwell on the past. See, I am doing a new thing. Now it springs up. Do you perceive it?